Computer Hardware, Lecture 4. Now, last week we suggested that the start of the internet really came about because of America had fallen behind the Russians in the race for rocket technology. Here we have a dispute about this. Let's have a look at this.
To finance high-tech research, one area it focused on was the extraordinary notion of computer-to-computer communication. The idea was pioneered by Leonard Kleinrock, whose work became the foundation of the ARPANET.
The ARPANET was designed to provide computing capability to the researchers that the Advanced Research Projects Agency, ARPA, was supporting. And each one of us who got a computer would modify it and make it a special purpose machine. So every new guy who came in said, not only buy me a machine, but I want the capability of all those other machines out there. Well, ARPA said, we can't do that. And then they conceived of the idea of putting these machines into a network. So if I wanted graphics, I could go log on to the machine at Utah, do my graphics there, and bring the results back. That was the initial motivation for the ARPANET. There is a myth that's been going around for 30-odd years that the ARPANET was constructed in order to protect the United States against a nuclear attack. False. Totally false.
Okay. So we'll think about that alternative answer. Let's move on. Now, last week we had a look at the first means of communication over a great distance. Samuel Morse had come up with the idea of the Morse code and got a grant from the American government to put up Morse code capability from Washington to Baltimore. 40 miles. Here's the Morse code, and we're looking at the first message. What was the first message? What hath God wrought? Okay. The next system was the telephone system. Here we have Alexander Graham Bell talking with his assistant, Mr. Watson. The first telephone message was, Mr. Watson, come in here. Then we come on to the third mass communication system, devised by Ray Tomlinson in 1971, who was working on a program called Send Message, and he sent the first network email. He also devised the idea of using the at sign. This is Ray Tomlinson. What was the first message? Well, there it was. Now, if you look at this, the assignment, the third part of the assignment says, where are computers going? Well, this is rather astonishing, isn't it? A virtual keyboard printing onto, not printing, shining onto a table so that you could actually type onto it, not a table, a surface. This is an actual laser image. Wow. Okay, what are we going to deal with today? We're looking at how to make a computer hardware. Then we're going on to PowerPoint and perhaps more access. Okay, an English mathematician, philosopher and inventor. He invented this, the first programmable computer type machine. Who was the man? Here he is, Charles Babbage.
An English gentleman named Charles Babbage designed the world's first true computer in the middle of the 19th century. He called it the analytical machine. An English lady, Ada Lovelace, daughter of the poet Lord Byron, produced the world's first computer program to operate the analytical machine. Well, the truth is, they never quite finished their machine. It was at least 100 years before its time. The car electricity, you see, had not yet been invented, so Babbage was restricted to using wheels and cogs to represent numbers in his computer. And to power the machine, he had to rely on a steam engine. He constructed models, but the complications of so many rods and wheels, and ratchets and gears, and the tolerances needed were too great for the technology of his day. And though he devoted most of his life and his personal fortune to the effort, it remained a practical failure. His programmer, Ada Lovelace, actually hoped to use the analytical machine to pick winners at the racetrack. Well, this didn't work out either. Babbage's analytical machine may have been a practical failure, but it had all the ingredients of a true computer. One, it had an input device. Babbage used stiff cards with holes punched in a particular pattern.
Okay. What we're looking at is two things: punch cards and the census. Now, first of all, every 10 years in the United Kingdom and in America, they count everything in sight. In England, we're talking about a census where they count all the people. The next census is in May 2011. If you go back to biblical times, you'll find that Jesus' mother went to Bethlehem for a census, that all inhabitants of the Roman Empire should be numbered, that a census should be made, which could be used for effecting better taxation. The second thing I was looking at was punch cards. Now, if you look at the idea of punch cards, here's a card with four holes in it. On a punch card, how many holes do you need if you're answering the question yes and no, male and female? A, B, C, D. Nobody chose A. Lots of people suggested 2, B. One person suggested 3, and I couldn't figure that out. And some people suggested 4. Now, it depends. If you look at a hole there, you could use one hole filled in for yes and another hole empty for no, so you only need one hole. Or you could use this hole for yes and this hole for no. So the answers 2 and 4 are both basically correct. All right. Herman Hollerith, a German American, chose punch cards as the basis for storing and tabulating. Here he is. Look at this. There it is. He's making punched holes. There's the picture of him. All right, let's have a look.
Let's see. This is a Hollerith census machine. Herman Hollerith, the man who came up with a better way of doing things, made some money, but is mostly forgotten today. What is the Hollerith machine? Well, it has to do with the American Constitution's requirement to take a census every 10 years. Starting in 1790, every 10 years, the American government has taken a census. The next one will be 2010. Everything was counted: horses, dogs, sheep, cattle, pigs, how many wagons you owned, if you were a railroad, how many engines, if you were a ship owner, how many ships you owned. Anything and everything of statistical interest for economic purposes for government planning. What you see here is an 1890 machine used in the 1890 census. A better way of focusing, calculating, organizing the information. In 1880, the American census took about 5 years to collect all the data. It took another 4.5 years to complete the census. If you hadn't had the Hollerith machine for the 1890 census, it wouldn't have been complete in 10 years. These machines revolutionized large-scale information handling. The 1890 census took about the same time as the 1880 census, even though there were 16 million more people. What did it do? It provided a more organized way and a faster way of processing information. A large data sheet would be marked. It was organized into a matrix. The matrix in turn would be processed so that a punched card could be used. How was the card punched? A machine like this one, an operator would take a look at the data sheet, place a card in here. If there was a mark on the sheet, it would push down, punch a hole in the card. Then you'd take the card and you'd put it in a reader. 80 spring-loaded pins electrically connected to the counters on the machine above. You put the card underneath, press it down, there was a bed of mercury underneath. Mercury is a liquid metal that provided the ground for the electrical circuit. There was a hole.
Okay, so we know how Herman Hollerith managed to do this. Herman Hollerith, just incidentally, was the founder of IBM. So he managed to go a long way with his system. Now, we're looking now at how to build your own computer. What are the steps that you would take? First of all, step one, gather your materials, case preparation. Install a power supply, install the CPU, install the heat sink on top of the CPU, install some memory. Then configure the motherboard. Install the motherboard, configure the motherboard and case, configure the hard drive and CD-ROM, install the hard drive, install the CD-ROMs, and install the video card. After that, you go through that. Well, they're basically
Hi everyone, I am Paul and I'm back with New 8 TV. Recently we've been doing a lot of video editing here in the office for our YouTube channel, and we found it necessary to rebuild or replace a few of our computers. Laura actually burnt hers out completely while editing video. So I'm rebuilding my computer today and we're going to be featuring the Cooler Master.
I don't really want to advertise that Cooler Master anything, so I shall go for this one. We can see here all the components that he's using. Ointment. Alright, he's protecting himself against static electricity. Now note the way that the CPU fits into the case there. There's no forcing or anything, he just drops it in, doesn't he? Yeah? Now he's applying a small amount of paste here so that the heat generated by the CPU, you remember there were 42 million transistors in a CPU, the heat could go off to the fan. There's the fan there, so if it is generating a lot of heat, then the fan can take the heat straight away from there. I think it's much more difficult to connect all the wires than they suggest in just connecting up the computer. Here he's putting in RAM, isn't he? All right, random access memory. This is what makes your machine faster. He's putting in two pieces. The more RAM you put in, then the faster your memory, your computer will operate up to a certain level. Now they're doing this very quickly, and so he'll only do up a couple of screws. Remember, power supply. The power in your home is AC, in the machine is DC. So the power supply is a sort of transformer, isn't it? Note, he's talking about a mainboard or motherboard, gently positioning it, fixing it so that there's a distance between the motherboard and the case. And there we are, basically. He's added a second fan. Again, I would suggest that putting the pieces in is quite simple. It's making sure that you know where all the wiring is going. It is the more difficult part. Now you should go to hardware information and just watch this video yourself. I think it is an excellent video. The graphics or video card, or graphics and video card, the hard disk he's putting in there, main memory. Remember, this is the one that revolves at 100 revolutions a second. Right, so connecting up the cables. Putting them into the power supply. And essentially, he's done. He went through those sort of steps. Let's move along. Now I'm suggesting there's the main hardware on your machine, those 10. Monitor, motherboard, CPU, RAM, etc. Okay. Now if you look at this, there's your motherboard. Let's have a look at the connections. The CPU. There it was. 42 million transistors in a CPU that was around on sale in 2000. The brains of any PC, central data processing point. What's the AGBT slot? All right, the graphics card. Video card. PCI slots. Sound graphic video cards. All right, so those are the slots for both of these cards. ISA slots. Yes. Again, expansion board, putting the slots there. CMOS battery. Look at this. Going to the hard drive. All right, so the linking up point. Now there's the hard drive. There's what it looks like inside. There's a diagrammatic representation. Okay. You should look at the chipset. Make a special point of going through what the chipset does. There's the power supply, and look at this, AC to DC. Flash memory, solid state storage device. Okay. That's what we're looking at.